I'd like to thank WIRE for supporting me with a summer fellowship in 2015. And I'd like to thank the Albright Archaeological Institute of Jerusalem for supporting me as a Seymour Gittin Distinguished Professor. It's probably the closest I will ever get to being distinguished despite my gray. So I appreciated that. The University of Edinburgh Library looked after me, let me in without cost when I was in Scotland. And I also would like to thank Danny Sion of the Israel Antiquities Authority for giving me access to all of his archives and photographs and everything from the Gamla archaeological excavations. So let me begin this way. Jews have worshipped their God for more than three millennia. And because of the books that they have come down to us in the Bible, we know a great deal about how they worshipped. In a nutshell, there have been temples and synagogues. The temples, whether we think of a temple of canvas, hide, and wood and call it the tabernacle, or a temple of stone in Jerusalem, the more typical way, these temples were places where the central form of worship was sacrifice. We have evidence of these institutions from about sometime in the second millennium BCE, all the way up to 70 CE when the Romans destroyed the Jerusalem temple. Synagogues began to appear in the third century BC in the archaeological record, primarily in Egypt, and became widespread and long-lasting. They seem to have spread throughout the Mediterranean world before going with Jews wherever they traveled and have lasted as the primary institution of Jewish religious worship up to today. In them, the primary forms of worship are scripture reading and communal prayer. Now, unfortunately, we lack the evidence to determine what form of worship took place in the earliest synagogues. It is not until the first century CE, coincidentally the same century as Jesus and the birth of Christianity, that solid evidence for synagogue worship began to appear. The best evidence is for the practice of scripture reading and perhaps sermonizing. Communal prayer is clearly taking place among the Jews, but whether it is practiced in synagogues is another question and one that at the moment goes unanswered. So let's focus on what we have evidence for, the reading of Torah and other parts of scripture. I'm going to show you some evidence and then just so you have a sense of what we're looking at. This is a stone inscription, quite nicely done, that would have stood outside of a monumental synagogue in Jerusalem sometime in the first century. It reads this thusly: Theodotus, son of Vetinos, the priest Anarchosynagogos, son of Anarchosynagogos, and grandson of Anarchosynagogos. And if you can't guess, Archaeosynagogos sort of means ruler of the synagogue. And so we're talking about Theodotus, who built the synagogue for purposes of reciting the law, nomos, and for studying the commandments, and the hostel, chamber, water installations to provide for the needs of itinerants from abroad. So what we have in this synagogue, we only have the inscription, we don't actually have the synagogue itself. It's a place of worship, particularly for reading scripture, studying the commandments, and there's also a hotel next to it, or part of it. And there they have some sort of bathing facilities, maybe they're just mikvaot, water installations, as well as rooms and so on. Philo Judaeus, who wrote in the first half of the first century, says this about synagogues. What then did he, i.e. God, do on this Sabbath day? He commanded all the people to assemble together in the same place and sitting down with one another to listen to the laws, to the nomos. Nomos is the Greek word for laws here, to the Torah with order and reverence, so they should not be ignorant of anything that is contained in them. And then here we have Josephus, Flavius Josephus, who writes at the end of the first century, and he says this: For ignorance, Moses left no pretext. He appointed the law, nomos again, to be the most excellent and necessary form of instruction, ordaining not that it be heard just once for all or twice or even on several occasions, but that every week men should desert their other occupations and assemble to listen to the law and to obtain a thorough and accurate knowledge of it. Now, what's important that I want you to see is from these three sources of evidence from across the century, we know that people are reading scripture publicly in groups, they're gathering in synagogues to do it, and that gathering happens on the Sabbath. But notice what is missing. We don't have a ritual. We don't have any liturgy here. The only first century evidence that we have for liturgy in a synagogue, particularly one referring to scripture reading, comes from the Gospel of Luke, written probably in the 80s CE. We at least have a little bit of a description of a ceremony here. Jesus stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," and so on and so on. And then Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of everybody were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And all spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. And they said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" So here's Jesus. He's showing up in the synagogue, in a Jewish synagogue. I mean, after all, Jesus is Jewish, okay? We haven't got Christianity yet. And he reads. Okay, he stands up, he does the reading from a scroll, and he sits down. He gets a good reception here, okay? They are all amazed at the words that came out of his mouth. Now, what's weird about this passage is he goes on to insult his audience. And I'll spare you the details. We'll come back to this. And he insults them so much that they get angry, and they stand up finally in a rage and grab him and try to throw him off a cliff. Luckily, it's a mob. They're not very coordinated. He gets away. So what I want to do today is to give you a sense of a new approach to thinking about worship, to thinking about liturgy. This story is missing something. This story talks about movement, the movement of people, the movement of the attendant, of Jesus. What's missing? The space in which they move. There is no description here of a synagogue. We have no idea what it looks like, okay, from the passage. And this is pretty emblematic of the way liturgical research in ancient Judaism has been going. Okay, if you look at the history of Judaism, the history of Jewish liturgy, at the history of worship, what you discover is that they don't care about what goes on. They're working with the historical texts, whatever the texts say, largely which is about words, that's what they're interested in. Nobody in liturgical studies has ever sort of turned around and looked at an actual synagogue and wondered, I wonder what would happen if I put the liturgy in a synagogue at the time. And what I'm going to do, and it works the other way too. Archaeologists are digging the dirt people. You know, that's what they like to do. You know, they like to dig with rocks and things, and they think about architecture. And a good field archaeologist, you know, thinks that the final goal of the project is to produce the final report, the description of the finds, perhaps a reconstruction of what the complete building was, some dates, you know, maybe something about the people. But by and large, that's where they stop. They don't do worship. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to try and take these two parallel tracks that have never talked to each other and try and, you know, tie them together, see what we learn. And we're going to learn some cool things. We're going to learn that the architectural shape of a synagogue actually impacts the way you understand how worship happens. If you don't actually know the space in which the worship takes place, you're missing key information. Second, by looking at actual synagogues, it fills in some gaps in our knowledge about liturgy. And third, the architecture itself, we will learn, can reinforce the bond between the congregation and the sacred scrolls and actually determine the ritual interactions that take place during worship. Now, I'm going to play with this story from Luke 4, not because I'm fascinated with Christianity, but because it allows me to show you how different spaces change the meaning of the story, change how the story works. All we have to do, we don't have to change any words in the story. All we have to do is change the place in which it takes place. So, Christians frequently read the Gospels. They hear them in church services. They study them in Sunday school, in Bible studies, reading them by themselves. And most of them probably don't even think about the space in which this story from Luke takes place. But they have to imagine something. If they have any mental picture, they have to imagine something. And what they probably imagine is something that more or less looks like the church in which they worship. And most modern churches look like this. Rows of seats facing forward to a central platform in which people stand and speak or read scripture or whatever, and so on. So if we imagine the Jesus story here, Jesus would be sitting about halfway back in the pew, let's say, and his time to read would come, and he would get up, walk up the central aisle, stand at the first or second podium there, read the scripture, turn around, go back and sit, and then according to the story, he would begin speaking, and all eyes would be on him. Does it work? Look at the space. If you're sitting behind Jesus, all you're going to see is the back of his head. If you're sitting in front, you have to turn around and wrench your body to see him. And the longer he speaks, the more likely you are to turn around and face forward and say, nuts to this, I'll just listen. So that would suggest that whatever Jesus says, the communication is missing most of the information. You can't see his facial expressions, his hand gestures, his body language. All you can hear is his voice. Okay? That cuts down on his ability to be effective. And when I think about it, I say, nah, this isn't going to get him killed. Okay, you have to have better communication connection in order to really get a crowd riled up and get yourself killed. So I look at this and I say, I don't think so. It's the wrong kind of synagogue. But, you know, modern synagogues look the same. I'm not picking on churches. And we can even go back into antiquity and look at some of these synagogues here. So, for example, over here, there we go. Here's the Susia Synagogue from the 7th century. Over on this left side, we see the remains of the platform. And straight across the hall, you have benches, rows of benches facing the synagogue, facing the platform. Similarly, up here at El Kanatir, you have a raised platform at one end of the synagogue and an open area here. And most archaeologists posit that people sat in front of this platform in rows of benches. So very much the same kind of thing. But we aren't quite back to the first century. And if we go back to the first century, we have four synagogues that we can look at. And one of the things that we discover is that they all are sort of the same architectural type, all different from what we've been talking about. This is the most famous of the synagogues, probably, the synagogue at Masada. It's built by Jewish rebels in the first revolt against the Romans in 70. And notice what it looks like. Tiers of benches all around the room facing an open area. It's a largish open area, so we have to have rows of pillars to support the roof in some way. Not fancy, rather unadorned. Okay? In fact, there's nothing actually Jewish here. I mean, that would identify it as being particularly Jewish, except that we know that the rebels here were Jewish. Okay? So we know it from context. Herodian, second Jewish revolt against the Romans in 130, again, built in a Herodian fortress. You can see how this is put together here. We have this open central area with columns, surrounded by, in this case, two tiers of benches. Now, something different here. Behind it is some sort of a landing that goes all the way across, and at the back of the landing is a row of stone benches against the wall. So this theme of benches surrounding an open area with columns is beginning to look repetitive. Now, here's Gamla. I'm sorry, not Gamla, Migdal. Migdal is Magdala in Aramaic, perhaps the home of Mary Magdalene. And again, you see the same thing. Central area, two tiers of benches around it, remains of columns, a landing behind that, surrounded by benches against the wall. Okay? we're beginning to get a theme here. This would be a wonderful synagogue to study, except it hasn't been published. Okay, it was discovered 10 years ago. They have built a marvelous tourist site here. Have they published anything? Not really. So we're left with the Goblin Synagogue. And luckily, this is the best of the synagogues to be left with. We have great remains. We know exactly when it was built, essentially first decade of the first century CE. And we know almost to the day that it was destroyed in the spring of 67, when the Roman army came through this area, sacked this place after a siege, and destroyed it, never been occupied since. So we have direct access from whatever dirt came in to the first century. Wonderful kind of a site to dig. It's been published, and it's in a village. Okay, a village perhaps much like the ones that Jesus moved around in and worshiped in. Jesus was never here. Don't let me give you that idea. But this is the best example of a first century synagogue that we have. And so let's think about how this might have worked. And I'm going to do three things in my talk. I'm going to first tell you about the architecture that the archaeologists discovered at Gamla. And then I'm going to give you a little bit of my methodology, and it won't be too heavy duty, and you can follow it. Don't worry about it. I won't use any big words. And then we will bring the methodology into our data and see what we learn. Gamla is way north. Jews in the first century live in two places in the land of Israel, down here in Judea near Jerusalem, up near Galilee, and really it's around the Sea of Galilee. So the Gamla is not in Galilee proper, but it's in the Golan Heights to the east of the Sea of Galilee. It's on a big steep hill with an interesting crown, actually sort of looks like a camel hump, and the city, the town, the village comes down this side. It's all steep. There isn't a flat place in it. And when they built the synagogue, they had to carve out a platform in the side of the hill. And this gives you a sense of what the synagogue looks like. Open area, benches around the open area with columns, a landing around the outside of that. Here's the main entrance, which leads you out, and underneath this roof is a mikmah, an immersion pool, and you have a street right here to the left. And if I take a picture, an aerial shot across that street, you see you can get a sense of the steepness of the hill. You have the street, a retaining wall that's about 12, 15 feet high, with some stairs up into the complex, into sort of the back door. You have the synagogue itself on a constructed platform carved out of the hill, and behind that you have another retaining wall holding up the upper part of the hill leading north. And so I'm going to give you a little bit of a sense of sort of the complex of the synagogue. You have the hall itself, and we'll come back and look at this in a little more detail, but most of the stones represent the benches. You have the open area, and you have the main exit here. You have a row of rooms that are attached to the backside that are clearly part of the synagogue complex, and they get filled in when the Romans are coming, so that when they were excavated, the excavation was essentially pulling out 4 to 5 meters worth of stone fill. And then on the west side, you have sort of an entrance complex, a couple of rooms, storage rooms, and this hallway here that joins the main door and sort of the side door. So this is what it looks like a little more close up. And what I want you to notice from this shot is that you've got all these nice benches and this nice stone, and in the middle it's all dirt where weeds are growing. And this is the way it was built in the first century. And we'll come back to that. You see the exit. And if I turn around and I take a photo from the exit, you can see how this is set up. You still have the dirt and three tiers of benches here. That's on the north side going up the hill. On the south side going down the hill, you can tell that things have been falling. Okay, you were down to sort of one bench here, and then there's the second, and way back here there's just two stones to represent the third bench. If you count, here there looks like there's five benches, but I'll fill you in why that's not correct. There's only three. And so what I want to do is walk you through this, and I'll use this as my paint by numbers set. And we start with this floor. And here the floor has chips on it. In the 1990s, they decided to open Gamla up to tourist business. They built some paths down, a nice road down, and they had to come in and reinforce various things about the synagogue in order so it could handle the human traffic. And one of the things they did is they filled in all the dirt areas with chips. So that it's just added in. It hasn't really changed anything. But what I want you to know about this central floor is it's a built dirt floor. Underneath the 3 or 4 centimeters of dirt is about 5 to 7 centimeters of cut rock chips laid very carefully upon a complete foundation of field stones. So somebody spent a lot of money creating this dirt floor because the dirt was the foundation for a nice set of carpets on top. And they didn't want to go to the expense of cutting stone to do this, but they needed a good solid foundation for the carpets. So this whole dirt area, I want you to imagine, with lots of color, perhaps carpets 1/2 inch thick, neat designs and patterns, and so on. Let your imagination go wild, okay? Around the outside of the dirt area is about 1 meter of paving stones. And the paving stones hide a foundation for the columns. Okay, you can't just sort of set columns in dirt. They tend to sink, so you have to build a foundation for them. And that's there. And I want you to notice that there's a foundation of paving stones in the middle as well. And that also is for columns. We have 3 benches. I've coated them in green, pink, and blue. They're all preserved on the north side. They're not quite as well preserved on the south side. The west side only ever seems to have had 2 benches, didn't ever have 3. And on this end, we have 3 benches. And on top of the 3 benches, we have a platform. And at the back of the platform is a built bench against the wall. And this platform raises the people above the benches all around and all of the other sides. And in addition, there's a basin. This purple thing to the north of the platform is actually a basin. If you can see the 2 little lines right here, this represents a channel that comes from a cistern about 50 feet away. And to channel the water into this basin, it would come through the wall here in this picture. This is a picture looking down. And then the channel would come here into this basin. It's about big enough to wash your hands, maybe dip a small cup. And there's a hole in the bottom of the basin that links it to another channel that takes it out underneath this landing and out this door here, and ultimately to the mikveh that we saw. The landing, it's all dirt, but not constructed dirt. It would have also been covered with carpets like the central area. And then, of course, just to finish this, we have walls, of course, enclosing this whole thing, about 3/4 of a meter thick. And they went pretty much all around. We have preservations of parts of 3 of them. The south wall is completely gone. There are 3 doors. The main door, a small door in the northwest, small door in the southeast down onto the street. But over here is the important thing I want you to note. This is a closet right here, a closet. It's about 1 meter wide, 1 meter deep, and it's 2 meters high. And in the archaeologist's interpretation, this is the place where the scripture scrolls were stored. I will call it a Torah shrine, just for shorthand. We don't know how fancy it was. It was probably had some sort of a wood design, doors to it, which of course have long rotted away. And of course, to hold up the roof, we have columns. Okay, there's 18 columns here, four rows parallel to each wall. And in the middle, we have two extra columns on that, what we call the stylobate, the foundation for the columns. And what we get, if you look at the geometry of this, is a perfect square. And so I look at this and I say, given the importance of geometry and liturgy and being balanced and equal, I look at this and I say, this is the location for most of the worship activities. Okay, somewhere in the middle of this square. All right, that gives you a sense of what the archaeology is. We don't know what the roof was like. All we know is it didn't have tiles. But let me talk about method for a minute. I'm going to use a method that's going to be largely invisible to you, but I want to flag it because I am using it. I call it affordance analysis. It was originally designed by J.J. Gibson, who wrote a book, The Ecological Approach to Perception. This is a marvelous theory. It has spent a lot of time with heavy use in software design and game design and all this other cool stuff. And also, by the way, it's enabled architects to learn how to analyze the use of architectural buildings and features. And that's the direction we're going to go. In a nutshell, in a very small nutshell, the key concept is this. The physical environment, whether we're talking about nature, whether we're talking about constructed buildings, or we're just talking about objects, okay, they afford certain kinds of activities and disafford others. And if I remove the jargon from that, essentially what I'm saying is that architecture and architectural features enable or encourage human beings to do certain kinds of activities, and they discourage or prevent them from doing other kinds of activities. So if you think about this room, okay, there's a wall there. You cannot walk through that wall. Okay, affordance theory says that disaffords entrance, the wall. On the other hand, there's a nice door right there. And that door allows entrance, so it affords entrance. That's it for the jargon. Okay, you got the principle here? Just a quick caveat. First, if nobody sees what a feature can do, if nobody perceives it, nobody's going to use it. So just because the architecture allows you to do it doesn't mean that anybody's even going to notice that it happens. Point two, just because somebody notices doesn't mean they're actually going to do it. Okay? Nobody has to walk through that door right now. They see the door, oh yeah, that's an entrance. They don't have to go there. So in the modern world, when analysts are doing things like studying a shopping mall and the use of the design, the architectural design of a shopping mall, they do ethnography. Okay? They follow groups of people, figure out what they do. They stand by a feature and watch what different people do when they walk by. You know, they accost them in the hallway and ask them questions. Would you do a survey for me? So it's very much of an interactive kind of thing. They want to know what people are doing. In antiquity, of course, everybody's dead. So we can't watch the move, we can't ask them questions. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to substitute what we know about worship, liturgy, and liturgical movement. And so in the end, we're going to exchange observation of live behavior with observation of historical records of past regularly repeated behavior. Now, why is that important? Because that's exactly what a ritual is. A ritual is regularly repeated behavior, and the more you spend time thinking about and studying ritual, you learn that these repeated activities rehearse a relatively fixed sequence of actions and behaviors, and they do this every time they're performed. So if we have a synagogue, which is a building built for liturgy, purpose designed, we have a building whose architecture we can look at and say, They designed this with the idea to enhance, encourage, enable the right kinds of liturgical practices. Okay? We can't prove that, we can't demonstrate that, but it's a reasonable assumption. And so let's see what we do if we think about this. Did I go backwards? Did I skip? Yes. Gamla Synagogue. Okay. The first obvious purpose is that this thing is designed for congregation. So first thing you think about when ritual are people doing rituals. But what's important here is that people watch. 60% of the space is designed for the watchers. Whatever's going on in that central area, it's important that people watch. And we can get almost 200 people just on those benches alone. If we throw some wooden benches on the back landing, we're well over 200. All right? From affordance theory, okay, audience sits on the benches. The benches try to force people to look at the center. Yes, you can turn around and look the other way, and your mother will probably slap you for misbehaving and force you to turn and look at the center again. Okay? So the way this architecture is put together, it pushes the audience to look center. Everybody can see it. Most importantly, the benches are egalitarian. There's no indication of hierarchy, of status, etc. Anybody who sits anywhere on the benches is essentially the same as everybody else. And my last point here is that, what is my last point? Yeah, everybody can see each other, okay? You look across the way, and seeing the other members of the audience, of the congregation, reinforces certain kinds of behavior. Okay, if it's a solemn moment, you know, if the liturgy is going on, maybe a prayer is being said, you know, you look down, maybe you have your hands in your lap, you're being quiet, your body is being still, and if you look around, you suddenly realize, oops, everybody else is doing this, I'll do it too. Or maybe it's an informal moment, things haven't started yet, okay, it's a little bit more rowdy, you're talking with your neighbor across the street, you see Joe over there, hey Joe, how you doing? You know, the teenage boy sees that girl he's sweet on, he winks at her. She blushes, her mother swats her, you know. So there's communication here. Just because you're sitting doesn't mean you can't communicate with people somewhere else in the room. And that's important. And we do have this platform. We can't ignore it. This platform, in my interpretation, is a place for hierarchy. Okay, a place for the leaders of the town, the leaders of the synagogue, the synagogue officials, perhaps, like the attendant, okay, in Jesus's case. Or maybe also you get some temporary people up there for honors, like that day's scripture readers. I don't know. Here's an interesting problem. We want to talk about reading scripture. How do you get the scripture there? How do you put it in place in this central area that everybody is steering at? Well, you could ask yourself, why not just have it there from the beginning? Okay, but think about how this works. People come in the main entrance and they walk across that big open area to their seats. And the family comes in and they've got three kids and the two boys are having a fight, and the next thing you know, one of them knocks against the reading table, the scrolls fall off on the ground. I mean, it is nice carpet, let's not forget, but you don't want to do that, okay? They're sacred scrolls, you want to show respect. So I would argue they're not there, not at the beginning of the ritual. You have to bring them in, okay? And one of the nice things about that is from affordance theory, we actually have a very clear path for this to happen. The hazan, the attendant, is going to be sitting up here on the platform. And the first thing he's going to do is he's going to walk over to the basin. He's going to handle scripture scrolls. He's going to walk over to the basin and wash his hands. Okay, ensure that he doesn't have any residual impurity that he's going to convey to the scrolls. Maybe he's going to invite the two or three scripture readers from that day to join him as well. And then he or they are going to walk over to the Torah shrine in the corner, and they're going to get the scrolls out. Now, I don't know if they're going to get out individual scrolls or if the scrolls are in a box like an ark. That's what we call the thing we move scrolls around in an ark. So they pick up the ark, let's just assume that, and they go out the side door, come around to the main entrance at the main level, and they come in. You see the problem? Where in the world are they going? 40% of the building, this whole big area, open area, they could go anywhere. Is there a place they should go? Well, remember that we have this perfect square formed by the pillars on these foundations. So I would put the reading table right there in the middle. And that would mean you'd have to place the ark to one side or another. I mean, I picked that spot just for the hay of it. It could be almost anywhere. So your Hazan and readers would come in, place the ark down, and possibly sit here on the green benches for their turn. So what's happened? We've taken the scrolls out of their hidden place, out of where nobody's thinking of them. Okay? We've brought them into the congregation, and now the scrolls are among the congregation. The congregation surrounds the scrolls. The scrolls are part of, they aren't above the people. They're at the same level as the people. They are bound symbolically, okay? I'm in religious studies, we get to talk about symbolism, okay? It's all right. The scrolls here, the congregation of the scrolls are bound together, and the scrolls represent the tie between the people Israel and their God. And I want to emphasize that you know, while I'm an academic and I tend to think in sort of academic terms, this for them is an emotional bond. Okay, this is important to them in here in some way that isn't intellectual, it isn't analytical. It's an emotional tie here. So there's an identity emotionally between the people and the sacred scrolls that are being moved around. Okay, now we finally get to the ritual we want to talk about, scripture reading. Affordance theory gets us about this far. Somehow the scrolls have to get from the ark, the storage area, to the reading table. That's it. The architecture isn't going to get us any further than that. Analyzing the architecture, we've hit a dead end. But if we go back to our Jesus story, we've got some extra information. He stood up to read, the scroll was handed to him, he unrolled it, found the place, he read, he rolled up the scroll, he gave it back to the attendant, he sat down, people watched him. Okay? We've got a description of a set of activity that we can use to at least investigate this ritual a little further. So this is essentially generalizing from the comment about Jesus to general practice here. All right? And I'd read it, but it's essentially what I just told you. However, if we do an affordance analysis of the movement, we have to add a couple things. First, we have to indicate that Jesus moves to the reading area. It's not just he stands up from his seat, reads in place. Okay? He has to move to the appropriate place. That's why it has to happen. Second, he takes the scroll and he places it on a table. Okay, now if you've ever thought about this, okay? It's not a book, it's a scroll. Here's a book. I can hold it in one hand, flip around. What page am I looking for? Where's 32? Can't do that with a scroll. Okay? A scroll is a big, long length of hide or parchment with two battens at the end. And in order to move it all in the scroll, you have to move both. One lets out, the other takes in. And you have to do it at the same time, or it starts getting long or gets too short. Etc. You have to put it on a table because you can't hold it up and do this at the same time. Okay? So there has to be a table here. We've got three participants. We've been talking about it. But let's think briefly about the scrolls' movements. In the Jesus story, the attendant gives the scroll to Jesus. Jesus reads, gives it back to the attendant. But an affordance analysis would require us to add You take it from the storage, take it from the ark. The attendant must do that, gives it to the reader. So what we have is the attendant's and the attendant's activities bracketing the reader's activity. So let's see what we can do with our ritual here. All right? Here we got the reading table there in the center of the column square. We've got our reader. Where does the reader come from? Anywhere and everywhere. We have an egalitarian seating arrangement on these benches. They can come down, whether they're on the green bench, just stepping into the open area, or maybe they have to scoot somebody aside who's in front of them, step down from one of the higher benches. They come to the table, they come to the table. The Hazan, who's got to be standing by the scrolls in the ark, he picks the right one up and he gives it to the reader. Okay, so we get this ritual going. The reader reads, gives it back to the Hazan, returns to his spade. So notice what's happened here, just to do a little bit of religious studies analysis here. The reader comes from the congregation and returns to the congregation. The reader is a representative, a member of the congregation. The Hazan, the attendant, is also a representative, but in a different way. He's been officially charged with his role. So this whole movement of Torah scrolls and readers is a movement of the congregation, by individuals who have in some sense been deputized by the congregation in this reading. The reader receives the scroll then from the community and undertakes the reading at the invitation of and by the authority of the community. And this is the point I want to make. This congregation gives the sacred scroll to the reader. That's what the ritual has accomplished. And then the reader now reveals the contents of the scroll to the congregation. So on the one hand, it's a controlled set of activities, controlled in some way by the congregation, representing the congregation. But on the other hand, it's the only way the congregation gets access to the contents of what's in the scroll. And this is important because this isn't modernity, where all of us have gone to school since we were 4 or 5 years old and we've learned to read and it's been a high priority. This is a world in which, if they're lucky, 5% of the adult males can read. Almost none of the women. So reading actually at this time means to speak. It actually is the same verb. Okay, to speak is to speak. To read scripture is to speak scripture. People read out loud. So that gives us Jesus, and that gives us sort of our conclusion about what the ritual is, at least as far as we've been able to push it. So let me just come back to the Jesus story, and then I'll finish up. Here we have this nice little story. So let's have Jesus. He's sitting there in the front row. He walks up to the reading table, stands there. The Hazan brings him the scroll. Jesus reads it. He hands it back to the Hazan, and then he returns to his seat. And then what happens? Everybody first listens to him talk. They're amazed. And then he starts insulting them, and they get all upset. Okay, so what's the interaction here between Jesus and the congregation? So what we know from the story is that they're watching him. They begin by watching him. He goes up and he reads. Of course, they're listening. They watch him as he returns. And as he sits down, they're still watching. That's what the text tells us. The eyes of all the synagogue were fixed upon him. And they watch and they listen. And he starts off accepting, and then he says things they don't want to say. So think about what the audience sees, sitting on the green, the pink, and the blue benches. First, they see Jesus talking. That's what the story tells us. But they can also see each other. They can see the consternation in Mary's face. They can see the anger welling in Joshua's eyes. They can see somebody clenching their fists, and then it increases because they can see each other. They react to each other. They're responding to each other. And so what we have is a crowd that can develop a course of action without ever moving from their seats, because they can communicate across this space. Ultimately, they work each other up. Finally, the anger tips over, and they stand up, they rush Jesus or whatever they do, and grab him and try and take him out and throw him off the cliff. So with that, just let me conclude. We started by making an argument that we needed to bring together the archaeology of the synagogue, the architectural character, with the study of the liturgy practiced in the synagogue, and on the assumption, on the argument that it would tell us something. And it told us all sorts of cool things. We learned how the architectural space was used in worship. We learned how the architectural space shaped the worship that took place. That allows us, finally, to bring that understanding to stories and tales like in Luke 4 and interpret them differently than one might think otherwise. But most important, it shows how the architecture can reinforce the tight bond between the congregation, the people of Israel, and their scripture. And that bond places, in this case, scripture among the people rather than above the people. So with that, I thank you very much. Yes?
How did they know there was carpet?
There's two arguments for carpet. Well, at least two that I can think of at the moment. One is, when we move two or three centuries down the road, we start getting mosaic floors, and the mosaic floors imitate carpet. They have the edging, they have the tassels, and so on. The other thing is, this is a very expensive building. This is the most expensive building in this village. There is nothing comparable to it. None of the homes have cut stone. None of them have pillars. Nobody has any money in this village. This is just a little village. So to put all this effort into the stone and build a dirt floor as the central thing requires, something's happening here. And I and the archaeologist would argue that it's carpet.
Question number one, is there a directionality to architecture? In other words, in some cultures, if you have a door facing north, that's inauspicious. Mm-hmm. Is that true in this culture?
In about two centuries, we will have explicit orientation of the synagogue towards Jerusalem. And it works in about 90% of the stuff we've excavated. So up in Gamla, you would want an orientation to the south, almost due south. Unfortunately, because of the hill, the shape, it's 30 degrees off. And so there's a scholarly debate about whether there's any orientation here or not. And you know, if it was only 10 degrees off, I would argue absolutely. And I have said in some of my lectures that, oh yes, absolutely, there's orientation here. And I did that in front of the excavator. Yeah. I did that talk in front of the excavator, and he sort of took me down, at least on that point. He liked the talk in general.
So my second question, your thesis is the bringing these movements bring the scripture among the people. And I want to probe this a little bit with regard to class.
All right.
And specifically with regard to literacy. Mm-hmm. Right? So you... And also maybe gender, because you mentioned, well, maybe they saw Mary. And that's mm-hmm. surprising to me right there, that there would be women present in this egalitarian space. Okay, mm-hmm. But that may be a sort of a subsidiary question.
Okay.
So literacy didn't necessarily only, it wasn't only limited to the priestly class.
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes, literacy, we have a class of scribes. Okay, we have a class of scribes, probably trained in priestly auspices. We don't have a lot of evidence for scribes except that we have their writings. We don't know enough about their education. But given that in the first century, we're doing a lot of political upheaval from the death of Herod the Great in 4 BC onwards. So the only stable institution in the whole country is essentially the temple. So I would assume that scribes are trained by the temple. that would emphasize scripture reading as well as, you know, writing and
right.
legal stuff as well.
Okay, so literacy doesn't necessarily enjoin class distinction.
That is correct.
Okay.
That is correct. And that it becomes the same when we get more information in about a century or so.
Okay.
That'll be the same as well. Yes?
Well, in this congregational setup, what are the evidence for walls and roofs, and what effect might that have with the congregation?
Very good question. We have the remains of three of the four walls. So we have the north wall against the hill. We have the west wall, which has those two doors in. We have the east wall where the platform is. And I didn't point it out, but there's actually a window right above the bench there into the next room, not outside, but into the next room. Given that all three of those walls are essentially built the same way, we hypothesize that the missing south wall, which fell down the hill, is essentially made the same way, was sitting on top of the support wall that came up from the street, probably had some windows in it. It had to be light somewhere. And so either we have to imagine there are windows there, or we have some sort of a clear story in the roof or something. We don't have any evidence for the roof. We know it's not tile, because no tiles were found. Neither there, and they went down the hill. They excavated immediately down the hill and then did some survey further down. No tiles at all. So it's not sort of a classic Mediterranean red tile roof. I've been working on an article where I've reconstructed it. I've put like 8 windows in the south wall, about a yard and a half wide, like the one that's above the platform on the east. So I'm taking that as my model. I wouldn't put a clear story up. I would have an arched roof with some kind of covering, and that's where the problem comes. I don't know what the covering is, you know, because wood, it would be mud and straw. We don't, you know, thatch, which is used sort of in the northern European edges of the Roman Empire, isn't used here. One famous archaeologist, Ehud Netzer, suggested that it was a flat roof, like every other roof in the village, made out of mud, you know, with some reinforcement. That just, I mean, given all the money that went into the stone and the pillars and trying to make this building special, I don't buy it. Although it would make for a nice flat ceiling and it would solve other problems for me if I went that way. So I haven't got a good answer on the roof.
It seems funny why the Romans didn't have some description of these places. Do you have any theories of why they didn't? It's just something to destroy.
The Romans didn't, at least we don't have good records from the Roman, anything officially Roman. All of our records come from other places. We actually have a fellow by the name of Flavius Josephus, who was originally, according to his own story, a general on the Jewish side against the Romans, and he switches sides about 3 months into the five-year war, and then he becomes a writer. Okay, he joins the Flavian household of the emperor Titus, and he writes. So, all of the scripture material we have from this period comes from him. Everything else is archaeological, and he does describe this battle. He describes the fall of Gamla, and so we actually know like what day it happened on. You know, about tea time. So it's the archaeology confirms more or less what Josephus tells us. You know, it's not a huge amount, you know, it's a paragraph or two, but it's nice to have at least that overlap. And we've dug some other sites from the war. I mean, wars are wonderful for archaeologists, you know, lots of destruction, people run away, often they don't re-inhabit, so everything is just left there, so you can find it. You know, long times of peace, you know, people remodel, they change things, they don't remodel, they just live in the same space. You know, you can't find anything.
So your thesis is that the arrangement with benches on almost four sides would lead to a different sort of ritual presentation, and yet we still have somebody reading at a table, right? Which is still like sort of like an altar in front of a row of seats. So he would have had his back to most of the people, or side or something. Wouldn't that be odd? I mean, might there be some other kind of thing going on in the middle? Like, I don't know what. A rotating table?
Actually, I mean, I'm going to cheat here. Okay, I'm going to jump 1,000 years into the future and tell you that in European medieval Jewry in particular countries, this is exactly the way they do it.
Yeah.
They have a reading platform, so it's actually raised. It's not down, it's raised with seats around it, some of which face it, others of which all face forward towards a Torah ark, and then the reading table is in the middle. Much like the church of the time, actually. So if you go back to the 3rd, 4th century and look how the basilicas are organized, particularly the 4th century, they start with an apse and an altar up at one end, and then gradually they come down the center until the place for the sermon, the ambo, the place for the sermon, the place for the reading the Gospels is in the middle. One of the things I've been working on that this talk led to, and I'm desperately trying to finish this article, is the thought not of visual, but of oral. Because what's really important is what it sounds like. Can people hear the Torah being read? Can they hear the sermon or the prayer? What's wonderful about Gamla is there's actually enough preserved that I can actually work out the acoustic model of this structure. I have to make a few assumptions, okay? I have to figure out what I'm doing with the roof. And at the moment, I cheated and went with the flat roof because I figured, oh, you'd have to plaster the bottom of it, and that just solves the whole problem, and it gets rid of a whole set of calculations that I have to do otherwise. But I think we need to be thinking more, particularly with ancient buildings, about what the sound was like. What was the purpose of this building? With the temple and with sacrifices, the sound isn't important. It's the visual that's important. But in the synagogue, we've dropped all that, and suddenly it's what you hear that's the real key.
So I have a question about Jesus' age.
Okay.
So he's 12.
Okay.
I don't know what the history of the artist is, but I mean, is there any sense, perhaps as you're trying to sort through the possible liturgical aspects of this, that this is a rite of passage?
The bar mitzvah is clearly a rite of passage, but we don't start getting evidence for until about 200, which probably covers most of the 2nd century AD. But it's clear from the Gospels, which are written, say, in the latter half of the 1st century, that they assume that something's going on. Certainly Luke does, in terms of a bar mitzvah, some sort of a tradition at 12. We don't have lots of details. The bar mitzvah is very clearly a synagogue ritual as opposed to a temple ritual. Okay, so it rises as the synagogue begins to replace the missing temple. We don't really see it prior to that. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming, and thank you for staying. I really appreciate it.